Northern New York County Gun Club, some guy from out of state moved in to some property next door. And he didn't like the fact that the gun club was there, and he found out that the state law says if you can't shoot a gun within 300 feet of another residence. So he built a little shack 100 feet away from the shooting range, and he shut them down. We don't want that to happen either.
No.
But that is a danger of something that could happen.
Is that York County Fish and Game?
No, this is Northern York County.
No, but they did it, I believe they did it in Cape Elizabeth.
Yes, right.
And they did it in, I think, North Sanford or North Berwick.
Sanford, yeah. That is a danger that we face.
Did he get a permit to build it?
Probably not. I saw the shack, probably not.
I mean, you want to go.
It's not a legal residence.
I'll go with you, buddy.
But that's an issue that we have to deal with as well. And we have to make sure that people understand. I'm of the opinion, you move next door to a rod and gun club, I don't care how much noise they make, that's not my problem. You should have researched it before you moved in.
That's my point.
Well, it would be a disclosure issue when you bought the house, because you'd have to disclose that.
You wouldn't think.
No.
No, why would you have to disclose that?
Follow up on Yance's.
I think they could go back.
If I may, about revisiting portions of R1. I understand that everybody made a good faith effort when they, in drawing the lines between R1, 2, 3, and 4. However, everybody acknowledges at the table that R1 is not the growth area. And I think everybody can also acknowledge that there are portions of what is currently designated R1 that should not have been designated R1 to start with. And I think just shutting the door on, I'm not suggesting that we should get into it tonight, but I don't think it's appropriate to just shut the door and say, we have to absolutely positively have to leave the zoning lines exactly where they are. I think the mistakes were made when it was originally done.
It seems like a zoning issue.
It is a zoning issue, but
it's not a zoning issue, it's a council issue. Because they're the ones that have said where the boundary lines for the various districts are located. It's not, the planning board doesn't have control over that. We may not like it, and we probably don't, but if the comp plan comes along with the plan, it's, Jens is saying, well, we've got this section that probably should be different. The comp plan has to make that recommendation, and then the planning board would look at it, and we'd all end up going to town meeting. But it doesn't start with the planning board.
And to Tom's point, I mean, I understand that, and Tom has a better understanding and a longer history with dealing with the issue, and so I appreciate his response to my inquiry. But I think it can go the other way, too, and there are probably areas that could be added to R1
mm-hmm.
to lend itself to that type of use. It's not just a one-way thing taking it out of R1. Mm-hmm.
There's no question about it.
Oh, a lot of time and a lot of work went into that when we did it. And it wasn't just throwing a dart on the map. But it's really hard to project growth. Mm-hmm. Really, that's like mm-hmm. I think anyone can.
Crystal ball.
Right. So, but this is where we are now. It doesn't mean that growth isn't going to, you know, us trying to have a vision and, again, somewhat control of what our town's going to look like in 10, 20, 30 years. So even though it didn't, that R1 is not built up now, doesn't mean that by keeping it a Route 1, it sort of like funnels that in the future. Doesn't mean it's right now.
That's true.
Very honestly, also, frankly speaking, that Mark's got just about the only large pieces left in R1. The Schweiker property, which everybody points to, is breaking it up. Most of Bert's property is not in the R1, and most of it is in the wetland area. This back portion of his land, he's got basically also a tree growth.
Does it abut 2 or 3?
He's in four. He's in four. Most of his land's in four.
No, the one on Mountain Road. The one that's in one.
Mountain Road is Mark's?
Yes.
Mark's just goes up to the Oliver property, and from the Oliver property on that's R2, I believe.
Right.
but it's gonna stay in farming, that's the thing.
And that's the thing, that's out. It's off the table.
Right.
Mark's land is all off the table.
This was my point. My point is that if we have areas that we know are problematic, and they abut another zone, and it's, and you can flip them and resolve the issue, then we should probably consider doing that if that's the best way to resolve the issue.
I would make the point, from the planning board's point of view, we're talking about the R1. Whether it's the R1 the way it is now, or the R1 the way it will look at some point in the future, we're talking about home occupations in the R1.
No, I'm going back to his question. When he asked the question about can you, that would go back to the comp plan. That would not go to this meeting or to the planning board. That would go back to the comp plan.
Yeah, it's just for our purposes, we're just looking at R1. Wherever that happens to be,
right,
this is what it will end up looking like. I think we need to go back, if we can get a list of businesses that are currently in R1 that we know of, and then we can look at the conditional uses that we've said and decide that we want to put type 2 in that list and say that they may or may not be allowed.
Yeah. Or do we put a limited type 2?
Well, no, because we're limiting home occupations anyway. If you're a home occupation, this is what you're going to look like. Anything else is going to be a regular business,
okay,
wherever it happens to be.
Okay.
And if you want to do something besides a limitation of, quite frankly, you need a 4,000 square foot house to have a 1,000 square foot business in it.
Okay.
But you don't have a lot of
them. There you go, sir.
We're talking about small activities, and it sounds like we're talking about what you folks are concerned about is something larger than a home occupation. And so I would reiterate that maybe we need to go back and look at conditional uses and look at that again and say what's missing in here that really should be allowed in here, that could be limited by having a larger lot. You could say you can have this kind of facility if you have X number of square feet. Good example exists in here right now, pet daycare center. That can be a scary thought in a residential district. You have a yard full of barking dogs. But if you look in the conditional use standards for that particular use, you have to start with a 10-acre lot in the R1 district. And that's the key thing. So if there's uses that you think are appropriate that would be compatible with a residential district, just we need larger area for it, we can do that as a conditional use with the stipulation it's got to have a minimum lot of acreage. That's one way to do it.
That's
the problem
right
there.
That's one of the arguments I lost.
Yes, you did.
So I own a kennel, part of a kennel in New Hampshire, and it has 13 acres, and it is grandfathered, but it's in a residential area. But it abuts, it's the first property beyond rural residential that made it an R1, a single family home. So I could continue to operate this business until I died, but I couldn't sell it because I was grandfathered. But because my property line was contiguous with a rural residential property, because I was the first, lot beyond that designation, I petitioned in the town for a rural residential designation. And because of my physical location, because I was right on the line, they gave it to me. So it means that if I can sell my property, and the next person can actually continue to operate it.
So was that an effective zone change, or was that the flexibility that you're talking about?
Well, that was the flexibility I was talking about. So yes, it's a zone change, and I was able to get a zone change. Because otherwise, that property could never have been sold again as a kennel or for any commercial use for that matter. The grandfather only ran with the owner of the house, and once that owner was no longer in possession of the property, it defaulted to whatever the current zoning was.
And I believe we had discussed that issue, and I believe I.
I know we remember.
And dog kennel, when you said that, was a particularly prickly conversation, because dog kennels are notoriously noisy, no matter how much, you know, acreage you have and how much of a discipline you impose on what goes on in your kennel. There's just no way to avoid it.
We had a discussion whether or not the permit went with the property or with the owner, and I thought we had decided it went with the owner.
But I guess what I'm saying is that was the flexibility, Jens, that you sort of were talking about too, that if you had that physical proximity that makes it practical and reasonable, you should be able to change your designation, I think.
Well, you're always allowed to.
And that's sort of what I was talking about.
You're always allowed to go and petition to be allowed to change.
And the planning board has done it. You remember we did that up on Old Alfred Road with Alpin's property.
I think we, did we do that, Donna, with one area, did we change that when we did the last change in the comp plan? Did we change them?
Well, we did have townhouse corners and.
Well, yeah, we were.
Gateway district and all that.
The mixed use districts.
Yes.
Right, and then there was one area that was.
Yeah, along the river.
Was one little tiny area that was separated from the rest of it, did we put it in?
Oh, yes, I couldn't tell you right now where that was, but yeah, I recall, yeah.
Was that Fritz's place? Does that recall?
No.
No. Cause that was an R1 that was hanging.
No. I think this one, part of it was in two, I think, and part of it was in three or something.
I don't remember, but.
But we adjusted it, things like that can be adjusted, yes.
For the sake of time then, let's get a list.
I just want to clarify something. When you said that the property, like the business, stays with the owner, does that include kids, like family line ownership, or? I'm just curious, I was just trying to clarify that statement.
That's a good question, I don't think that.
Because like if she had a son or a daughter that wanted to take the business after her, they own the property.
Yes, and in New Hampshire, it would stay with a child or a relative, and I don't know how far out you can go, but it would, the grandfather would be extended, because the property technically wouldn't change hands in the same way it would with a sale.
Yeah, that's right.
So you can give your children property without actually having it be a sale.
We talked about it more from the point of view of you're selling it to somebody else so they could run a business there.
And under Maine law, yes, the non-conformity of the use stays with the land as long as the business continues to operate unabated. You can stop it for a period of time, here we allow it for 2 years. But it stays with the property and not with the owner. That's the difference than New Hampshire.
I like New Hampshire. That's another issue. Okay, but at the next meeting, let's come up with some ideas of what you think of what would be appropriate businesses in the R1. And we will take a look at the conditional use list and we can say, you know, for home occupations, it'll be a type 2.
Everybody has a copy of the land use district section? Sounds like we're going to have to send it out.
I don't know which ones were crossed out or which ones weren't, so.
I suspect mine may be old.
Yeah, we made some changes at the last, you didn't make the last meeting, did you? No, okay. So make sure that you get one.
We'll send out the list.
We'll send out the list.
So that'll take care of that, we'll put that on for the next meeting. And then we'll take a look at animals, husbandry. I'm not sure which one of these I want.
Well, they're two different. One is, well, what you've got is, remember, you've got definitions.
Yep.
Because we had to define what animal husbandry was, and we made a distinction on that. Because originally, animal husbandry, as it states right now, is if you have chickens and you sell eggs, you have a little honor code, we have a little
cooler.
Stand,
cooler.
Usually it's cooler. And you sell eggs, you're a commercial operation, and you come under animal husbandry.
No.
That's the way it's written right now. Now, luckily, most people who are selling eggs in a cooler probably don't need more than 5,000 chickens in order to run their operation. So it's not going to affect the chickens.
but,
Hope not.
Hope not is right, but there should be some sort of, there's still subject to, there's still subject to. And the question is, look, is that a commercial operation if you sell some eggs on the side?
No.
That's what the planning board said.
So maybe there should be a dollar value associated with it.
We've already got that.
Can I jump in here for just a moment?
I'm coming up.
Thank you so much. The ordinance as it was almost proposed last spring had many issues, and that's putting it very mildly. The dollar value was one of those issues because it was basically arbitrary and unenforceable.
Yep.
Okay? Absolutely. So if the dollar value that was placed on it last spring was $5,000. So if I was doing whatever, eggs, rabbits, doesn't matter, and came in at $4,999, then I was exempt from all of these rules. And I can pretty much guarantee you that every year I'm gonna come in at $4,999. Maybe in a bad year, $4,998. So that was one issue. And thinking about that now since last June, and looking at what we did with home occupations, I put together a little proposal to get us out from under that piece.
You didn't send it to us.
Oh, it's because it only happened today. I think before I type.
And I'm not surprised because this is hush.
Thanks. I love getting bushwhacked.
Well, no, it's not.
I love when Donna bushwhacks.
There's a bunch of copies here, so help yourselves. I'm sure that this is going to need a tremendous amount of work, but I think it solves some of the problems. Because the document that I'm passing around is basically the animal husbandry equivalent of type 1 home occupations. It's the invisible animal husbandry.
Wondering,
well,
is this townwide or is it just R1?
I could see it potentially applying everywhere.
Oh, okay.
But this is non-commercial. This is the non-commercial piece.
Then the domesticated animals for pleasure will not be fenced. It's not commercial. If I have horses for pleasure because I want to go.
Yeah.
To use your, I have 100 acres of land and I have a couple of horses and I want to be able to go out and ride them around for pleasure. That's not commercial.
Right.
So it's not covered.
This whole thing is non-commercial. This is the.
But this domesticated animals raised or kept for work or pleasure.
All right. So
it would have to be kept for work.
Pleasure, you're riding the horse. Work, he's pulling your wagon with your wood in the back. That's what I meant by work. I said this is going to need some work.
Okay.
This is thoughts on paper.
I love it. You just touched the third rails.
All right. That's why I get up in the morning.
I love it.
Thank you. I was afraid it was going to be me.
All right.
But this deals with animal husbandry that you're kind of putting a different. If animal husbandry only deals with commercial.
I disagreed with the definition that you had going. It shouldn't. Because if somebody's raising a few rabbits or the chickens with the eggs or what have you, that's still animal husbandry.
But
it's
an exempt activity.
Why make it hard?
I thought that was easy. It's exempt.
Okay. We can call it something else, okay? But it gets us away from having that mystical dollar limit that nobody's ever going to be able to know or enforce.
I think the only reason we have the dollar limit is if we get, it's just like, frankly speaking, it's like 25%. We're not going to go around and we're not going to have any cops busting in your home and say, you've got a file cabinet over here that's outside of that 25% area and we're going to bust it. It's there in sometimes to give guidance to people. But it's also there to, in the event that we have a gross violation, that it's a tripwire. It gives us legal basis in which they then proceed if we need to take it further and take legal action.
it's a basis in which we don't have it, we're not making an arbitrary decision that you're doing this commercial, we argue back and forth, and we find out that because you're doing more than 5,000, gives us a legal basis in which that the town, on behalf of the citizens, can take it to court if we need to. So it's the drastic situation.
But the tripwire here is that same one that we've put into type one for home occupations, which is impact. If basically what you're doing here is, and yeah, it's item two, you know, if what you're doing here is not adversely impacting your neighbors, and you're not, this is not your means of making a living, then this all of this is exempt. And then the next step is build the rest of it around what's
commercial
and covered by the main statute and all that other stuff that we have to be careful about.
And here's just to give you an idea, because I had to do the math. Okay, if $5,000 in a year, right? That's what you have, right? If you're selling eggs at $3.50 a dozen, which is what the girls sell them for at work, you would only be allowed to sell less than 4 dozen eggs a day.
How many chickens do you have that are raising 4 dozen eggs a day?
Well, we have 50.
That's a lot of chickens.
No, you'd be surprised.
50 chickens.
Well, you're lucky to get one an egg.
It's not.
Chickens,
chicken.
A lot of chickens.
Yeah, right. One per chicken.
No, it's not.
Yeah, it is.
No, it isn't.
Not really.
No.
It's not.
They snuggle up tight.
most of the people that I know that sell eggs, 10 to 12 chickens, 15 chickens maybe.
That's a lot.
It is a lot of chicken. When you listen to them, it's a lot of chickens.
See, when I had mine, I had some days that they laid more than one in a day. More in the summer than in the fall and the winter, because the colder it gets, the less they lay.
You got Diana wants some of them.
2 eggs every day. But I was only trying to make a point. With $5,000, if that was what the threshold was, then someone would be able to sell 4 dozen in a day.
60, 70 chickens.
It's only 48 eggs.
But that could be an impact on someone who's living next door.
I got an impact with 6 chickens because my neighbor's chickens are looking for a pot to climb into, and they keep coming to my house. They're gonna find it.
Already
ate half the herd
already.
No.
Yes, but they're also good bug control.
When you start considering things like beef or pork. Anybody who's been to the grocery store lately, okay, it does not take much. So that's one of the reasons why I don't like a dollar threshold.
The planning board didn't like it either.
Yeah,
we didn't know how else to separate it from hobby to commercial.
Yeah, because no matter how you do it, I mean, if we say commercial, define commercial.
Yeah, what does that mean?
Do you
because
put it on your tax return?
No, because what it
was a year of eggs is commercial. You're selling it.
But what it was is about room and boarding and everything else.
Well, that's what
that's where it came up to, yeah. The dollars and cents wise was boarding.
Boarding
no,
boarding
horses.
Oh, horses.
Yes,
yeah.
They're
not in this equation.
Yeah, but I mean
horses are totally different.
No, but it's still
they're not in this.
But again, how do you prove somebody if I have a small, you know, operation and I might have, you know, pigs and they have piglets and I sell off the piglets and, you know what I mean?
And let's say I come.
And I sell them under the table. And I sell them under the table. How do you know?
And I come by and I said, well, your neighbor's complaining because you had a litter of pigs.
I gave them away. I gave them away.
And they said that you sold them.
Don't you have enough to do?
Yes, absolutely.
Get along.
Yeah.
But look, what we're trying to do is just give somebody a threshold. It's not just for the towns. It's for the protection of the individual too. It's for the person who is doing this, maybe making a few extra dollars. Should they be called commercial? It's kind of to protect them as well.
Busy
say, look, hey, no, did I do 5,000? No, here's my tax return. Redacted everything, but here's my tax return. I didn't make any money.
So maybe you can give them a different title as opposed to commercial, like hobby.
I don't even want to regulate them.
We don't wanna regulate it, do we?
Right, and that's what this piece is.
Yeah, and right now we don't.
Cause the only thing we, the only thing we regulate with animals is if you're doing it commercially. And the problem with the definition is commercial is if you make a profit. That's a lousy, that's a too low of a threshold.
Yeah, there are a lot of commerce, you know, there are a lot of commercial enterprises that don't make money.
That's true too.
Another thing that I recall coming up in discussion last time, and I think it was Pam who brought this up. If somebody has ten alpacas and they call them pets, and they're not selling anything from them, then they have no regulation problem. But if somebody has ten alpacas and they're selling the wool, then all of a sudden they're a commercial operation. It's the same number of animals on the same land and the same impact on neighbors. What's the difference?
That's the dilemma.
And that's part of what I was trying to get at with this.
How do bees come about? Bees don't make noise that much. I'm just trying to,
How many animal units are a bee?
I haven't played with it, I don't know.
You can have a lot of bees.
My crystal ball on bees is one animal unit.
That's a good one.
That was just to give examples of something that people might be doing on their land.
I think we need to leave in the fact that it is commercial.
Well.
Because I don't want people to think, I don't want my neighbor to think because they've got chickens or they've got a couple of pigs, that's animal husbandry.
But it is animal.
But it is.
But it isn't.
Yes, it is.
It's not something we should be looking at to regulate.
No.
The guy has two pigs. I don't care if he's got two pigs. He's got six chickens. I don't care if he's got six chickens. But I think we need to use commercial to separate it out so they look at it and they go, we're not doing commercial animal husbandry. And well, I don't know how we're going to define that.
That's how you define it. There's animal husbandry as an overall category. And then there is the larger level, type two, if you will, commercial animal husbandry. But it's still animal husbandry. It's not agriculture.
Unless you go animal husbandry, hobby, and then
it's not hobby either.
That's not a good word. John is bringing up a very good point that very honestly, it doesn't matter whether you sell it or you keep it. Keeping of animals in a population that exceeds the carrying capacity of the land is an impact to your neighbors and to the environmental system.
Right.
Period. So if we're going to do that, that's going to affect everybody. And so that brings up a whole different, and quite frankly, Wayne Monroe, who many of you may know, who's a USDA agent, who worked with us on coming up with this system, basically said, yeah, you got to also deal with non-commercial animal husbandry because it can sometimes be a greater impact than the commercial operation because they don't have the facilities, don't have enough pasturage, don't have the manure, you know, management systems in place, and therefore you should take a look at that. And we said, one step at a time. If we can deal with the commercial first, then we'll have a ground to be able to.
It's like the pet pig. The pet pig that made the news, I can't gain any weight. Or else they can't keep it anymore.
This gentleman back here had a comment.
So what's to say someone selling eggs on the side of the road, $3 or $4 or $75 a carton? What if they put a donation box on the side? Now, does that still consider them commercial? If they put a donation, granted, someone's giving you a dollar, but now does that put it in commercial?
Technically, anytime you sell anything, it's commercial.
So if I sell my generator or my dirt bike on the side of the road, does that mean that can
that doesn't mean it's only one,
but if you're selling one every week, then yes, it becomes a commercial activity.
I don't agree with that either.
That's not my definition.
Yes.
That's the government's definition. That's what the IRS says is the definition of commercial activity.
Everybody else's business.
But I'm sorry, but just because the federal government decides to do something doesn't mean that as a town that has to be our threshold. We can have animal husbandry and then we can have a separate definition for what we feel is over and above what people would normally have as just a little side business, and then that needs to be looked at in a much, you know, if somebody has, and I'm just gonna use this, if somebody has 200 pigs or 200 cattle, that's different than somebody that has two cows and a pig.
I agree.
And I think the two need to be treated differently.
I'm just saying we need to define what we mean by commercial. I agree with Donna. Let's have a definition of what animal husbandry is, and then if we have two types underneath it, type one is an individual and what you do at home, and the same way we did type one for home occupation,
yes.
We're not gonna regulate it. I'm not interested in chasing down the guy who's got
no, and somebody selling eggs on the side is not gonna be considered commercial.
And they shouldn't be. But if you're, I'm gonna pick on Mark. If you're Mark Panette's a commercial operation. Just based on the size and the number of animals he has, he becomes a commercial operation. Setting a dollar threshold is an impossible standard to figure out. We've got to find some way to say what is commercial.
Well, either that or else, well, what we're opening up is we're saying all animal husbandry is created equal, and it should be based on the ability of the land to support the impacts of those animals. That's what you're saying. They're all the same. Doesn't matter whether it's commercial or whether it's residential or per home use. You've got to manage the manure, and basically it's manure and other impacts and other nuisances, especially if you're raising guinea hens, other nuisances that are generated by these animals. Whether you're just got five out there or you've got 200.
And are there formulas that
yes, there are.
So,
yeah,
maybe
but the thing is, it starts getting expensive. It gets expensive the higher up you go.
Another thing, reason why we didn't go that direction, because we wanted like nutrient management plans,
yeah,
and erosion control, and we didn't want to impose that on someone who had two pigs.
Right.
That cost, because it gets costly. You have to have a certified expert.
Well, Mark, we just did this last summer with you, right? We put in a feeding station and nutrient management pad. How much did that system cost?
I'm not gonna tell you.
Okay. It was more than $50, wasn't it?
More than I'm going to pay.
It's a lot of money to farm.
Yeah.
And the heritage of this community, and I just don't know why it bucks a little bit. We work over here as a commercial, and you guys go to work. Why aren't you commercial and pay the penalty that we have to pay? It's a lot of burden.
Well, who's putting the burden on you? Right now, we're not putting anything
down. Not yet, but it sounds like it's the clamp's coming.
But if we're using the same system that you use with Wayne, how is that any more burden than USDA?
Well, is that what you're trying to do?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. The lady with the yellow. Your
as
name
far
is
as I'm Cynthia Hodak. As far as I know, you in order to acquire a nutrient management system or plan, you have to have X number of animal units,
30.
And that number is quite high.
Yep. 30.
Right, so perhaps 30,000 pounds.
Well,
it's by 1,000 pound animals.
Yes,
right.
By.
When we looked at the nutrient management plan a year ago with Wayne, he was telling us that unless they got two complaints, they weren't coming out. If they came out, you were getting a nutrient management plan. And we pretty much said, you know, we'll let Wayne figure that issue out because we're not gonna make it mandatory. We'll let USDA determine whether or not you have to.
That's good.
Which is as far as I'm concerned, that's fine.
Federally and
yeah.
state mandated on both sides.
And what it did is it basically gave the plan that we did and said, all right, this is the recognized carrying capacity of land. It didn't even look at the soils. It just said, here's the general carrying capacity of the land, and this is how many of each of these animals you can have given per acre. And it's assuming rotating pasturage. And if you wanted to have more density, you put in a nutrient management plan. If you don't want more density per acre, you don't have to. So it was optional. So the nutrient management plan was if you wanted to have a higher density than the standard that was the threshold. And that, so it's not mandating it, it's using it as a carrot. If you want higher density for the acreage, you can do it. Now there's some flaws with the system that some of the dairy folks have mentioned to us, and that is when you do intensification, especially in, let's say, milk cattle,
that you, the pasturage isn't the same. And Chip, you had that same thing with beef cattle, right? I mean, you feed, you bring, you aren't pasturing them, you're bringing in food. Mark, you bring in food too.
Have to.
Yeah, you have to.
Was so, that rotational grazing plan based off of a 365 day plan? So for a place like North Carolina?
That was I don't know, I asked
Wayne and he didn't have an answer for that.
No, he didn't have an answer for me either on that.
And if you've got 300 cows,
right,
you can't graze, you would need, what, 1,000 acres? 2,000 acres?
Yeah.
Because you have to cut hay. So it was my understanding with Wayne that he developed that plan based off of a flawed system from down south.
Well, then we need to look at that plan again.
I think so.
Or have, and or in your situation, you've got an intense, I mean, you've got industrialized agriculture.
Absolutely.
And the intent is that you are doing this commercially and for the purposes of maximizing product for the smallest area or the smallest amount of resources that you have to.
That's right.
And that's a different situation, isn't it?
Exactly.
And that's got to be built into, because you're a true industrial, a true commercial operation.
That's right. And that's where the state plan falls in, because the state
right.
covers all of that.
Right.
And that was the issue with the plan last year,
right.
where Wayne came up with this idea, and it didn't reflect the Northeast, or even the state regulation that already covers all of this, which is very comprehensive. And the nutrient management system, it's not just based off of complaints. It's based off of actual data. Anyone can complain about anything.
Right.
Mm.
But it's based off of data. So what you have there, you know, for example, someone complains about smell. Well, manure is one of the things.
Right.
And field stacking is allowed. So you don't have to have a 300-acre manure pit. You can field stack as well. So there was a lot of flaws in the plan, and that's why we defaulted back to the state. And I completely agree that this is something that's definitely needed for residential zones, but I think we should let the state plan cover everyone else.
Well, that's interesting.
And that may very well end up being what we look at.
Can we get a call?
Well, there isn't much choice, because, you know, if you try to regulate a farm that's in a permitted zone beyond the state regulation, then you're violating state law,
right.
which opens up the town and the taxpayers to sue. And of course, people who have businesses have to defend those. So,
yeah.
Unfortunately, that would be the logical process.
Yeah, and we are, for the most part, looking at the residential neighborhoods in terms of how we handle it.
Mm-hmm.
Two points. The proposal that never quite got to town meeting last year included this nutrient management plan language at the insistence of Wayne Monroe and others. No one was ever able to tell me who, other than the Department of Agriculture, does nutrient management plans, or how much they cost. And the answer is, I still don't have anybody other than agriculture that does them. So if you have, and if you have fewer than 30 animal units, you can't even apply for a grant to get the Department of Agriculture to do a nutrient management plan. So I think that's flawed. The other problem that I think I understand your position, but I think what you're missing is that if you look at the zoning map of Alundum, yes, R4 covers the rural conservation district. We don't, in R4, there isn't a problem with the current, with what's currently on the books for Rundle for raising animals, pretty much. However, R1, R2, and R3, they're huge problems. What's currently on the books is incomprehensible, unworkable, or all of the above. And that I think is what we were trying to address last year and failed. But am I right that that's...
Well, I don't think we failed. I think we made a good stab at something. But was it ready for prime time? No. But we can't leave it alone. Because as you say, it's incomprehensible and unworkable the way it is right now.
What exactly is problem?
5 animal units, that's all you get per lot. In those residential districts, 5 animal units.
But I guess what I'm saying is, I asked last year, what is the problem that brought this about to begin with?
Five animal units.
We started looking at equestrians and horses, and it branched out from there into cattle and into other kinds of animal husbandry. So we ended up, when we first started looking at it, they were all together. So we pulled horses out completely.
And another thing was back to the size of the lot issue. We had, like, Mark being in our one residential zone with CD acres.
400.
Okay, but one's in the R1.
And it's never really going to be residential. I mean, it's nice to have the flexibility to break off a lot if need be in the future to have that flexibility. But the problem is the zoning now at this point doesn't equate with what's actually taking place.
We had the dilemma of understanding that what you have, I personally, and I'm not speaking for anybody else, it's a good thing.
Yeah.
And to allow that, yet if we allow it for you, does it allow for all of our one? And so we started looking at, okay, let's see how we can make it allowable in our one without impacting all the other neighborhoods that really probably doesn't belong in. So we started working, trying to see how we can come up with it. And a lot of it would be based on the acreage, but based also on ridiculous animal unit thing. So I think we gave it a good stab, but it looks like we struck out. So how are we going to get this right?
Did the animal unit thing come from the state, or is that something that we put
animal
in?
Animal unit as well. You want to take that one?
Sorry?
The question was, animal unit is, in fact, a USDA measurement, and it's used mainly for cattle. It's used for bovines.
They use it for the
nutrient
management plan.
Well, it's nutrient management. It's used in determining carrying capacity, and especially, from my eye understanding, correct me if I'm wrong, it's also used to determine pasturage, how much pasturage you need per animal.
If you only pasture.
Right, without supplements.
That's very important, if you only pasture.
Yes, if you only pasture.
Which we don't have.
That's the measurement. That's the standard unit. And so, for some reason, back when they did this, it must have been 2003 or something, they used animal unit because they were told that's what you use. And they came up with this arbitrary 5 animal units, which sounds pretty good if you're running just a little operation. And the intent was, you're running a little operation, but the issue is that it is in zones in which we now have active farming going on, and it doesn't work. And for your zone, you have no limitation in your zone. R4 has no limitation on it. It's the only district that does in terms of animal husbandry. R1, 2, 3 is the issue.
Yeah.
That's the problem.
But the plan last year covered everyone.
It covered
that
everything.
Was the problem.
It covered, yeah. And the issue was, why would we not, if we're going to use a density, it doesn't matter where you are, which district you're in.
Yeah.
So they said, we're going to use uniform density,
and that was the problem.
Covering the whole town.
Yeah.
But the only thing it didn't take into account was intensive agriculture, which is what you do, and Mark, what you want to do.
Which I do.
Which you do, yes. And you want to expand that. And that's the issue.
Well, Mark, considering where we are, we don't have a choice. You can't graze them in the winter here.
No. But there are those who might have smaller operations. I mean, Pam, you've got, what, 30 at the most? 30 alpacas?
17.
Okay. See, all right, there I'm wrong. But 17. You don't have 50 alpacas, in other words. So I mean, the intent of this was to also allow people like Pam to have more than the 5 animal units, if she wanted to, and that's the whole point. It was a way of trying to encourage agriculture and make sure it's linked to the carrying capacity of the land, so we don't create a problem. Mm-hmm. That's what we were struggling to do. And none of us are experts in this, so that's why we pulled the USDA in.
And even he wasn't an expert.
No,
coincidentally.
Can we get a copy of the state one before we have our next meeting?
Can you help me on that?
It's right online.
Is it online? Yeah.
It's. I just looked it up. Maine Department of Agriculture Manure Utilization Guidelines.
Is that it?
Is that it?
No, because it wouldn't be just manure.
No.
That's a piece of it.
Yeah, that's a section of it.
It's not the whole thing.
You can get it right online.
It's complex.
I'm sure it is.
Dealing with soils is complex and water.
Well, they're basically in soil types, aren't they?
Right.
Yeah, that gets more complex.
But I think the solution to that is relatively straightforward. If that's what the state says, and that's what we have in the R4, then in the R4 it's covered. And if we do this, if we do that in the R3, it becomes a question of how big an operation do we want to have in the R1, the R2, the R3. If they're big enough that they have to conform to the state, then okay, they conform. We make the ordinance say if you're of X size, X number of animals, or X number of acres, or whatever it happens to be, then you have to conform to what the state of Maine says. And we don't need to go down the road of trying to define that regulation. The state's already done it for us.
That's not 100% true.
Shucks.
The way that the Right to Farm Act works, which is nutrient management plan and all that stuff, is you have control over zoning where it's not permitted.
Okay.
So if farming is not permitted in a certain zone, then it's up to you. The Right to Farm Act and nutrient management plan, all this stuff doesn't cover it. So that's where we fell in last year, was we're in a zone where farming is permitted. So what the town says doesn't affect us, technically.
Okay.
Until you get to court. But it affects people who are in a zone where it's not permitted. Then that's where the town comes in.
Okay. Thank you. I misunderstood that, so we had nothing.
I'm sorry, but there are a lot of people in the town of Arundel who are what I would call hobby farmers. Do they sell their product to try to reduce the loss? Yes. But there are plenty of people, and Mr. Monroe came in, his attitude, his very first email said that farms only have one species on them. There isn't a farm I know of in Arundel, there are like four that have just one species, but most of them have a couple of cows and a goat or two and some chickens and whatever. And I thought that what we were trying to accomplish was to make it possible for someone to have more than two heifers and a bull if they had plenty of land and were doing it responsibly and not polluting the water. And I'm talking about in R1, R2, and R3, not R4.
And you would think that that would make sense.
Yeah, that's what we want.
That goes back to the argument of trying, as the community's in transition, having some level of flexibility and review to take into account that even though your property is in R1 and that use is on the books not permitted, but under review it makes sense and it seems consistent with the manner in which that property has been used in the past, I think that there should be some way to be flexible enough to consider things on a case-by-case basis, because the community is changing. And so if you're so rigid that you can't, deal with change, again, it's back to the other thing. Those that can't change and be flexible die. And so you have to be open, I think, to a certain extent without, throwing all of your cares to the wind, to the manner in which things are changing, and accommodate those that, have a historical presence in the community and those that are new and have other ideas about the way the land should be used. So it's all about being a little flexible.
Is one of the potential solutions for this using the animal unit designation for what it was apparently originally intended, large animals, horses, cows, etc., and coming up with another designation, don't ask me what right now, for small animals, so that you don't run into the, you know, I have 5,000 pounds of chickens issue, because it's silly, is what it is, and it's also meaningless.
That's why we came up with the stocking points, where we were equalizing between smaller animals, which have a certain number of animals per acre.
Well, but that sort of brings me to my next point, because another problem with last year's proposal was there was no accommodation for things that were raised in buildings.
Yep, that's right.
Okay, so if you had, as I did once upon a time, 125 breeding rabbits plus extras at any given time that never left the barn except if I sold them, you know, I had nothing to do with how many acres I had. I could have done that on 1 acre and nobody would have known. So, you know, I think we have to look at more possibilities for uses in various places. The other thing in relation to something you just said, but I'm going to kind of flip it on you, in terms of the town changing, just as sometimes farmland gets put into residential use or perhaps business use, as in Mark's case, what was designated as residential use is now suddenly back into big-time farming, because it can go either way.
Right, I agree.
So we have to allow for that possibility,
yes,
too. So not just look at the grandfathered piece, but, you know, sooner or later people are going to come to their senses and want to do more farming.
And that's why agriculture is a permitted use in those districts.
You have no idea how nice it is to live in my world.
It never left farming. It never went to residential. It stayed right there.
In your case, it did. Well, in terms of the intense use, I mean,
right.
Yes.
Yeah, the difference the town of Arundel has done, unlike the state, is they don't have a term called farm. They separated into animal husbandry and agriculture. And I think the intent of that was to be able to allow agriculture anywhere, but to regulate how much animal husbandry could occur within the residential districts. And that's why we got the system we've got now. Now that just assumed that you wouldn't have large farms in the residential district, and we know that's not true.
Okay, so for our purposes, because we're dealing with R1, do we want to allow farms in the R1?
We already do.
Yes.
We already do, but I'm talking about from an animal husbandry point of view, other than those that currently exist, do we want to allow?
Right. Unlike what you said earlier, if someone decided they wanted to come in, say for example, there's a 200-acre lot that's for sale, and someone decides that they want to come in and put a gentleman farm on it, and they want to farm it, more power to them. Go for it. You know, I don't think that once it converts over to residential, that it should never be able to put back in farming. If you've got the if you've got the acreage and the land, and it doesn't impact everybody else in the neighborhood, I think you ought to be able to convert it back. So if you have, just like you have farmland, you can sell it to residential. You should be able to take what's designated as residential but not built on yet, and convert it back to farmland or agriculture or animal husbandry. I think it has to be a two-way street.
And it is that way in the ordinance right now. So it recognizes, it's always recognized the farming heritage of Arundel, and preserves the opportunity for that heritage to continue and to be revitalized if the opportunity or the inclination arises. Usually it doesn't happen. Mark's done it. There may be others. I've talked to the folks who bought the Schwecker property. They're a debate. They're very interested in what we're doing.
Keep what you got left and down.
Oh, yeah.
The intent is to allow that, and to allow it to expand.
You paid big money from a Maryland outfit to bring back this information.
I'm sorry?
The Maryland outfit that came back and said,
those guys, yeah.
I could have done it for $10.
Yeah, we found that out later.
Let's get some consensus. Do we want to allow farming in all of the districts, all of the residential districts?
Are you using farming as the generic umbrella of agriculture and animal husbandry?
Yes.
Okay, just clarification.
Animal husbandry and agriculture. Do we want to allow that in all of the residential districts?
I'm just observe my observation I'm going to make. I know my colleague, my esteemed colleague next to me disagrees, because we
always disagree.
No.
See, they can't agree with.
I think on the low end, we shouldn't be trying to regulate this. I think it's just, it's too difficult a task. I think on the high end, with when things come to the need for nutrient management plans, fines, the state weighs in there, and they've been at it longer. At the lower end, it is all about impact. And if the impact is objectively bad enough, then the civil law provides a remedy. And it's, and it,
yeah, that's it.
For nuisance, it does. And it's not an easy thing to prove, but it needs to be. It needs to be a significant impact to cause a judge to say, yeah, that's enough of an impact. But the remedy is there. I don't think we need to get into the.
But that argument could be made for any kind of activity in any zone. If the impact is egregious enough, then we can let a civil judge decide, you can't do that, that's so bad. We shouldn't eliminate.
Oh, I'd like to be able zoning to do that.
Sets various uses in areas just because some judge someplace can make a ruling on it. I think we need to look at it and say, how do we feel about having that activity in the different areas? Now, you all know how I feel about doing almost anything in the R1. And I don't live in the R1, but I'm for the benefit of the rest of you, I'm opposed to business in the R1. It's a residential neighborhood. But if we're going to have it, then we need to regulate it.
What's your name, sir?
John Paul Jones.
Bergen.
Bergen. I completely agree with you. I think where farming is such a common use, especially in this town, that it could be handled on a person-to-person, case-by-case basis. And that's a good idea.
But you need standards.
That's right.
The state has them.
Nuisance has standards. Nuisance law does.
No, you're right, I disagree.
I love farming.
And farming is common.
Growing a farm, I have nothing against that. However, devil's advocate. My sister lives on a small 1-acre lot, not a rental. Goats, a lot of goats, billy goats. Guys, I have a small billy goats.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, tied them right up on my sister's trailer property line. For 2 years, she can't have barbecues, the flies are so bad. It has impacted her quality of life completely. There is no civil justice. They have not gotten any justice in 2 years for the smell of manure and the flies that the goats have attracted. Have you ever met a person that just vindictively, mm-hmm. well, we're talking about chickens like it's a joke. If somebody is so much of a jerk, they will get those 400, 500 chickens on that property because who knows why, I don't know why people would do that, but somebody would, and you really are trying to protect and regulate. If you are that neighbor that can't use your swimming pool or barbecue resource, then 2 years, 3 years, how long is it gonna take?
No, and I think that Donna may have hit upon some of this when you start getting into, they have to be penned, they have to be so many feet from abutting properties, that would have avoided what happened or part of what happens with your sister.
Yeah, maybe yes, maybe no. I think we need to have some kind of requirements of standards that have to be met. Yeah. They don't need to be as rigid as what the state offers, but I do think that we need to have them.
That's to protect both
sides.
Yes.
Because the only remedy in that case was for your sister to spend money on going through the legal system. There's that old saying that good fences make good neighbors.
No, they don't.
It's,
no, they don't.
Not always.
I do have something to say, and it goes along with what Dot just said, is, you know, taking things civilly, it's not fun. We're going through this now. Our neighbor erected a chicken coop, stuck it 50 feet, less than 50 feet from our well, and decided to throw chicken do over the fence. So, we have an attorney, luckily, but we do need regulations.
because there is that person that is going to cause a nuisance. And I'm not saying, there are farms, and we drive by the farm on Mountain Road, and love the animals. My dog loves looking at the animals. There are things, but there does need to be some form of regulation,
To avoid people who get too close to lines or from putting things that don't belong on other people's property.
I don't drink my water. I can't drink my water out of my well now because of that.
And like you said, civilly, I know that there's civil remedies like you were mentioning, and that's the road that we're sort of forced to go down because, like Tad knows and Jim Nagel knows, I mean, we've had conversations with everyone from the deputies to Tad to Keith. To the dog officer, to the people from the east. I mean, everybody points fingers at everybody, and that's where you end up.
And nothing ever gets
done.
There's
no consequence unless you go civil. Not with the town.
Town won't do anything.
Camp is opening their sewage out, running down the easement. You got chicken. I mean, these. I know it's beyond the scope of why we're here today, but like you say, that's exactly where I am, and that's sort of why I'm chiming in on that, because I have a neighbor that literally shovels the chicken feces over the fence. I get home from work and I'm filling up utility sleds with chicken shit that I'm bagging for evidence because I got a civil case. And I'm shoveling the money out. I'm the only one that's working. I mean, I'm a federal employee. I'm not even getting paid now. This is something I've been dealing with since 2011. You know what I mean?
And enough is enough.
So it's a very that issue hits home when you're talking about these types of uses. There has they were raising dogs in a camp. Where does all the feces go? You think it goes?
Does it go where?
They're shoveling on the Eastern Trail and in the easement, and you know what I mean. This is all up above my well. So people getting into these different sort of husbandry and animals and chickens and dog breed and all that's. I'm hoping that people make a smart decision so that there is some sort of a consequence or an enforcement function that the town has. Because right now, I talked to Jim today. Nobody can do nothing. Nobody can do nothing. The lawyer won't do this.
Yeah, but we can shovel somebody else's chicken do.
So unfortunately, that's where we're at. Literally. You know what I mean? So now, who knows where that will go? But now I've got my cameras.
You make a very good argument to have some kind of regulation.
Question.
Marty?
Something along that he was thinking. We have, let's say, building setbacks and whatever else. Is anything with that? And like on his case, you can't have a well within a certain distance of a septic tank. Mm-hmm. Can that not be possibly used something like in a case? I'm just throwing it out as an idea. I mean,
I said that to Jim today, and he says he doesn't.
There are
recommendations,
Marty, on distance from a well.
Recommendations on the distance from a well. If somebody is taking manure and shoveling it and throwing it over a fence, it doesn't matter how far away the well's supposed to be. The guy's throwing stuff over the fence.
Yeah, is there going to be a regulation? Are we going to pass a regulation about that in our ordinance? No.
No, we're not going to put that kind of
the remedy is
civil.
Unfortunately.
But it's going to take time.
But
it's going to be expensive, but that's...
I know.
But the point is that if you're operating the business and you're doing something like that, the planning board actually could have some kind of leverage. We could revoke the permit. If push came to shove, we could revoke the permit and have the CEO issue a notice of violation and have them shut down. It's extreme. This guy's got an extreme case. He's got a problem.
But we don't have a neighbor running a business.
Unfortunately, probably not the planning board knows of. So there's nothing we can do.
Well, there's several problems because the land use ordinance. It cites the Maine Department of Agriculture manure utilization guidelines. And in those guidelines, it says, about manure handling and not having it within 100 feet of a well,
right.
Private well, and 300 feet from a public well. And if we're having it if it's in our ordinance, And it's also, you know, that, that piece of it is being recognized in our ordinance to go to that guideline. Why is there no enforcement?
I'm gonna defer that question to the powers that actually control.
And that's why we're here, because.
But that's nobody here, that's the Board of Selectmen.
It's, well, the planning board also makes those.
No, that would be code enforcement or the selectmen.
It is codes enforcement, and codes enforcement operates under the Board of Selectmen, so if the codes enforcement officer is not doing anything, then you need to go to the Board of Selectmen and say, this needs to be pursued, this is what's going on. We don't have control over the codes enforcement officer. We don't have the authority.
You don't have the authority, but you participate in that, I mean, in making those ordinances and guidelines and husbandry and all that other stuff that you, what you're talking about tonight. It's all intertwined.
But it's not, we don't do the enforcement side of it, that is done by somebody else.
I completely understand that.
No, but I think your point, Melanie, is that you wanna make sure that if anything changes, that the safeguards that you think should be enforced, which is that you shouldn't be able to have it within this far of somebody else's well, shouldn't disappear from the ordinance.
Absolutely, right, correct.
So, so as we move forward, we need to be sensitive to things like what Dot brought up, which is they shouldn't be able to tie up their animals to somebody's property line, nor should you be able to put something within X number of feet of somebody's well.
Or house six dogs in a camper.
Okay, so this gentleman,
couldn't you, on a town level, I don't know if you've read the, it sounds like you've read the best practices. Best management practices for farming in the state. We've got a whole guideline which includes the nutrient management plan. Couldn't you use that to encompass the whole entire town, where it covers us already? Because that
it
would.
Does. It's in the ones. It's hard.
We represent.
It's in our town ordinance.
I guess what I mean is you would have a state guideline.
Right.
That would essentially address the issue that you had.
The issue with that is that we would then have to regulate everything, including the farm, the hobby farm that had one cow. We would have to be able to regulate it to know whether or not they were violating it. And we're trying to
avoid permitting.
We're trying to avoid having everybody come before the planning board to get a permit.
Well, you don't need a permit to follow best management practices. I guess what I'm saying is,
from our point of view, we need to know about it. So if you don't have a permit, if you have a permit and you violate it, the planning board can take action through the revocation of your permit. If you don't have a permit, there's nothing the planning board can do.
Except if a neighbor is having
problems.
There's
nothing the planning board can do. It becomes an issue for the CEO and the Board of Selectmen to address.
Well,
the planning board has no authority if there's no permit involved.
The issue is there a regulation in the town zoning ordinance, which the planning board enforces, or the CEO enforces, that requires somebody who is raising chickens non-commercially to meet, does the town have authority to impose best management practices, Department of Agriculture best management practices on their activity? That's the issue.
I don't know if this is best management practices. I think there's common sense practices, and that is.
Well, I don't have
any
common sense.
Let me finish. So, if we know that there are certain things that have happened that we don't want to have happen, like tying animals to the town, to the property owner's line, or you know, being next to somebody's well. There's nothing that stops us from putting something in there that says you can't do that.
Yes.
And would that then not give them, the code enforcement officer, whether they had a permit or not,
yes,
the ability, whether they're raising it for fun or raising it commercially,
yes,
it would give them the authority to be able to go in there and say,
yes, it would.
Yes.
And right now, and this may sound crazy, but any of you who have built a house here, you know this, we don't regulate wells. We don't regulate water quality in wells. We don't permit them. That's done through the state. And the only thing that the town has authority to do is through the Health and Human Engineering in the issuance of HHE 200s for septic systems. And there we have setbacks you have to maintain between a well and a septic system. But we have nothing in our ordinances, at least from the zoning ordinance standpoint, that requires wells to be placed, you know, any distance from any other activity.
Right, but I'm not asking for that. What I'm saying is, as we develop this animal husbandry and we decide on whatever it is that we want to do with it, I think in allowing this to happen, we also have to also say, but if you do this, this, or this, you're not going to be allowed to do it.
See, Donna's proposal, there has to be checks and balances. Donna's proposal does that have that a little bit in number three. It says they shall be contained in the building if, you know, they're contained. The enclosure with a setback of, and we would determine how many feet from abutting properties or roads, or you could put.
Right, and I said that earlier, Simone.
That says the same thing about manure.
Yeah.
Right, I said that earlier. I said Donna took the first step in saying that it has to be X number of feet away from your abutters.
Yeah.
But if we also, because we're all on wells, there's nobody in this town that has on city water.
But why?
Few. That's not true.
One is.
A little bit of
yeah, still very few, okay? The vast majority of people that are going to be affected by this are going to have wells.
Yeah.
So I think along with the, and I think that's something that we can do, is along from being set back, I think that it has to be X away from the person's well.
I think what Luke, if I understand you correctly, there's already something codified.
Yeah.
In the best practices, so
we
you
just,
can
that's why
you can have
state.
A list and be making a list until, no pun intended,
nope,
the cows
don't
come
show.
Okay,
right.
So if there is something already codified, and we can use it as a blanket way to assess what's going on and violations that are occurring, then we don't have to make these lists.
No.
We can use that as our guideline, sort of the way we were trying to use other people's lists of home occupations as a jumping off point.
But we already have that in the ordinance.
So
in
best practices?
Nope, but in animal husbandry operations, all pastures, barns, barnyards, and other area where the livestock or animals are kept, housed, fed, or cared for shall be a minimum of 100 feet from the nearest dwelling. We don't have anything that talks about wells, but we talk about a setback from somebody's house.
But what Luke is saying, it's in the best practices, correct?
Yeah,
so.
I mean, we can go through and we can add that in. And just, you know, okay, you've got to be so far from a well.
Right, and that's why I asked
yeah.
Tad to get the copy of the state.
A lot of that is in the ordinance now, in the current ordinance.
Yeah, I know. I'm just it doesn't
right.
mention
it just
best,
doesn't have the
doesn't
well.
Mention,
it doesn't
best,
mention best practices.
That's
and maybe that's what we should
then
put
the danger.
In
yeah, the danger of that. There's a danger of that. Then somebody who's farming, then they have to answer to two authorities then. State and the town.
Yeah.
A management practice.
Well,
if
they're if they wait
quality,
wait a minute if they're both the same,
well.
If they're both the same then.
Thank you.
What's the difference?
Mm-hmm.
If we say you can't have it within
100
feet of somebody's well and the
we
state says
yeah.
you can't have it 100 feet.
It's not two entities would be enforcing that, but yes. Those are the standards you'd look to. That's
right.
All. You just
yeah,
incorporate
from
it in the ordinance.
Yeah, we could just pull that whole thing in and say this is the standard.
If that's right.
And make that
the
standard.
Yeah,
yeah,
the standard.
Yeah, right. I think
that
makes
that
a lot of
sense.
I just want to respectfully I understand that there are problems with farming, but I want to remind the group that the current ordinance with the five animal units is extremely restrictive for somebody that has a 20-acre lot or even a 10-acre lot in R1, R2, R3, who's being a responsible person. And I also wanted to add that for horses, which apparently are special animals, as opposed to cows, the horse thing has already been done. We have the little horse stable and the medium-sized horse stable and the gigantic horse stable.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe that is an approach that could be used. I'm not suggesting that violating best management practices should apply to be allowed for anybody, or that you should be able to throw chicken poo over on somebody else's property. That seems a pretty clear violation of just decency. But I don't want people to lose track of the fact that what's on the books now is extremely onerous, and there, I guarantee you, there are tens, if not twenties, of people in Arundel in R1, R2, and R3 who are in violation. I forget, right now I've got a bull and two heifers is more than 5,000, because the damn thing keeps growing, the bull, I mean.
Is that the miniature bull you got?
And I'm not saying that I agree with the five units either.
Right.
I'm sure that that's...
That was all part of the original problem, we could never come up with that. So, I think at this point, we're gonna have to adjourn, because it's time. I just want one small item, looking at the definition of animal husbandry, raising and or breeding of domesticated animals not traditionally recognized as pets. Do we really want to have a puppy mill working out of a barn with a hope with 100 dogs being bred?
Puppies are traditionally recognized as pets.
Pot-bellied pigs are.
That's why. That's
yeah,
why they're.
Pot-bellied pigs are.
That's why they're.
Yeah, but
not part of animal husbandry.
I have a horse.
Okay, so I read.
Yeah.
Okay. Not a problem. Because I'm thinking, I don't want to start out regulating that. I want to regulate that, but not as the animal.
No, because it isn't.
I missed what Donna said, but it's funny because, I mean, the gutted camper full of dogs, well, to me, I tried to figure out what the definition without looking to what was a pet. But a pet isn't something, it isn't a bunch of breeding dogs that live in a camper without people. I haven't looked at Webster's definition.
Did we have,
but I mean, that's
the same neighbor.
So what is that?
The same neighbor.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
The same neighbor.
It's been going on forever.
Okay.
Our next meeting.
Good neighbor standards.
Really.
Yeah, the sugar people.
Yep.
Nobody does that.
Okay. So we have a choice, guys. But I get some attention. We have a choice for the next meeting. It can either be on the 31st of January or on the 7th of February.
31st of January. Let's get this done.
What day is that?
Yeah, it's a Thursday.
It's a Thursday.
Oh, geez. We're going to have 4 meetings in a row.
Yeah, that's why I was like,
Yeah.
But I mean, we could.
If we're going to have anything for June.
I know that.
This is slow. Okay.
Yes, it's.
And it needs to be.
You guys are well paid. Go for it.
Who's paid?
Who are you speaking about getting paid?
Yeah.
The planning board gets paid.
Yeah.
Not us.
Oh, not us.
No.
No.
I do this please. For love of town.
Nothing's free.
The trail. Very weekly. The town.
Let's not go down that
okay,
road. Let's
so
go down the road of where we're
going. We'll go down to the 31st of January for the next meeting. And that'll give us February 7th off.
Right.
What is February 7th?
Thursday.
Oh,
we have a.
Maybe it was a special day.
No, we have a planning board meeting on Valentine's Day.
That's sweet.
Sweet.
Family.
Oh, yeah. You're going to put the piranha out like crazy.
That's fine.
Make it a short meeting.
I would like to make it as short as the last one.
Yeah, that was a lot.
That was
should we all have up to the selectman standard?
Yeah.
Almost.
It was like fun. It was like.